Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
And welcome. As we gather in the name of Jesus Christ, we come together to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our brother in Christ, Richard Victor Schram, to give thanks for his life, and to commend him to our merciful Redeemer as we comfort one another in our grief. You've got a little bulletin there that has a few of the elements of our service this morning. And the first one is a thanksgiving for baptism. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, who formed us from the dust of the earth, who by your breath gave us life, we glorify you.
We glorify you.
Jesus Christ, the resurrection and the life, who suffered death for all humanity, who rose from the grave to open the way to eternal life, we praise you.
We praise you.
Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, the comforter of all who sorrow and mourn, our sure confidence and everlasting hope, we worship you.
We worship you.
To you, O blessed Trinity, be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Char, you've got your little book.
Pastor's going to help me get me through this. Dickie and I, we have this little devotion book, and every morning we read a page after breakfast, and he would always say, whose turn is it? And I always tell him it's his turn, but he knew I was lying, you know, kind of. But Richie died February 6th. And I went back and read the passage on that particular day. This book is like Jesus is talking to you. It's written that way. And I asked Pastor Scott to read February 6th and just listen to the words it said that day.
Jesus calling, February 6th. Come to me and rest. I am all around you to bless and restore. Breathe me in with each breath. The way just ahead of you is very steep. Slow down and cling tightly to my hand. I am teaching you a difficult lesson learned only by hardship. Lift up empty hands of faith to receive my precious presence, life, light, joy, and peace flow freely through this gift. When your focus turns away from me, you grasp for other things. You drop the glowing gift of my presence as you reach for lifeless ashes. Return to me. Regain my presence. February 6th. Thank you, Char, for sharing that with us. We'll have a gathering song played for us called Well Done.
Well done.
Let us now pray together the prayer of the day that's printed within your service bulletin. O God of mercy and glory, we remember before you today our brother in Christ, Richard. We thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until, by your call, we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading is from the book of Ecclesiastes, the third chapter. It only seemed fitting. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, a time to tear down, to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gospel reading for this day is taken from the Gospel of John, the 14th chapter. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of our Lord. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We've gathered together this day to do some very difficult work, work for which we have not really even had time to prepare our hearts, but work that must be done nonetheless. We gather this day to commit into the hands of God our beloved Richard Victor Schram, husband, father, grandfather, brother, uncle, and friend. And as we gather together in this place for this work, we find ourselves tossed around by our emotions. Our head and our heart are in conflict, and we find ourselves alternating between the grief that plagues every fiber of our being and the joy that lingers as a promise that we desperately cling to. This is the life of the Christian. A day such as this is a celebration, but it is also a time to grieve. When you come to a funeral service, it's really easy to see what's right here in front of you, to look at what the world has offered up for this day, and to think that death has somehow won. Because me, just like you, we feel so powerless. We feel overwhelmed in our grief, and we feel like all the control has been taken from us, that our loved one has been ripped from us, that somehow we have lost them. It's what the world would say has happened. It's what appears to be the case. It's just not the truth. You see, that's what the world expects of death. And in the poverty of our faith, we tend to believe that as well. But those who die as God's children are never lost. The only time that you really lose something is when you don't know where it is. And we know exactly where Richard is this day. I would say I don't normally bring paraments to a funeral. But to be more accurate, I never have before brought a parament to a funeral. This is a parament. It's a little altar cloth. And I brought it this day, for the very first time, for a very specific reason. Typically, this piece of cloth with that symbol on it is used on Good Friday. But as I was preparing the service sheet for you all, I was struck by Richard's middle name, Victor. I can honestly say, and it may be because I'm just a little thick, but I can honestly say I've never seen the name Victor in this way before. I know what a victor is, but when we apply it to an individual, it's always just been a name. Until I saw it blanketed by Richard Schram. The symbol on this parament, it's actually two symbols. The first, the middle one, is called a Kairo. It is the Greek letters, the first two letters of the word Christ. And the little wreath on the outside is called a Stephanos. It means wreath or crown. This symbol, the Kairo with the Stephanos, the name of Christ with the victor's wreath, symbolizes for us that although death came to our Lord and Savior, he was the victor over death, that he defeated death, and he did it once for all. And when I saw Richard Victor Schram, I thought, I'm bringing the Stephanos. I'm reminding them that his very name proclaims the reality that the world can't see if the world doesn't believe. And yet we as Christians, even in the midst of darkness and grief, understand that although we might feel defeated right now, that our hearts are broken, it's not the reality that God has waiting for us. It would be so easy just to say that, to say this is the symbol and this is what it means. Isn't it interesting that it ties in with Richard's name? But I can also say that this is something that he believed. And he would most certainly want that to be a comfort for you all today. In the midst of all the things that are dark and frightening and threatening and scary, and all the things that feel like it just defeats us to the point where we can't really even move or trust our own thoughts, we are victors. Just as Richard is a victor. So Psalm 23, a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Psalm 23 acknowledges this truth, that while we walk in faith, we also walk oftentimes in darkness, this kind of darkness. And yet, in faith, we trust that even in the midst of that valley, even though we are surrounded, or it feels like it, even though there is that shadow of death, God prepares for us a great feast. And that feast is the victory. And yet, we are human. And even though Jesus himself says, "Let not your hearts be troubled," they're troubled. But please understand this. The reason that it hurts so much is because you risked loving. It's an agreement that we enter into knowing full well that one day it's going to hurt. I am so glad that it hurts. Not because I want anybody in pain, but I want it to be the reminder of the great love that you have shared and will continue to share. I thank God that Richard chose to love, and I thank God that he's continuing his union with you in this same love. I had another thought. I know Richard loved you also very, very much, and he understood that love is a heavenly thing. And the greatest thing about love is that, unlike the rest of this worldly stuff, the more love you give, the more love you have. Unlike all of that stuff, all those ashes that reading that Char brought forward, that it says. And as I was preparing this, thinking about the idea of giving out love and getting more love in return, that love multiplies unlike the riches of this earth. Again, thinking about Richard, I thought about this one exception that jumped into my mind, and that is the seed. The seed and love. You take that one seed and you put it in the ground, and what happens? It grows. God willing, weather permitting, it grows, and it produces more and more and more. And Richard knew about this heavenly gift as well. As a matter of fact, once we get out to the graveside, you're going to hear this. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. There's more, but I'll save it. That's why we're here. We're here because this love has borne much fruit. Char, nobody knows about that more than you. For nearly 59 years, you and Richard shared a love that bore so much fruit. It bore a great many things. It brought about life. It brought about light. And that all Richard, though Richard isn't bound by this world anymore, that love never ends. As a matter of fact, each and every one of you that's gathered here this day, you've got that love and you've got that part of Richard that you will cling to the rest of your lives. He's part of who you are, and he'll remain that way until we no longer need these earthly husks. But it's not only love that we share with those who have died. We share the same promise of a heavenly home, the one that Jesus spoke of. When he said, I'm going to go and prepare something for you, and if I'm going to go to the bother of preparing it, then I'm coming back and I'm taking you there so that you are with me. Richard is not lost to us. He's just changed addresses. And we're the ones left with the hard, hard work of living. Living here in this place without him. I never know when I get in front of a group of folks that love and sorrow like this. I never know where you were in your relationship with the beloved dead. And in this case, it was such a surprise. I don't know where each of you were, and you were each in a different place. There's no question about that. And so I want to also offer you this one gift that we are given by God that is more of a practical thing. Today is about more than promises, although the promises don't get any better than the promises we receive in Christ. But it also brings you this. As you grieve and as you sorrow and as you bring with you your personal relationship and where that was in this world with Richard, you do so being offered God's love and forgiveness. That means that you get to forgive in that radical love, that crazy love that promises an eternal future. You get to forgive anybody that has anything against you, anybody that has wronged you, anything that was left unsaid. But you also get to forgive yourself, knowing full well that Richard takes none of this with him. Forgive yourselves. Forgive yourselves of the things said or the things never said that you always meant to. Because that love, it only gets more and more pure as we leave this earthly business behind. Although you grieve, you will continue to live. I pray that you do so, putting your trust beyond all reason, putting your trust in this radical love that God gives you and that God continues to hold Richard within. Trust. Trust when everything inside says it's just darkness and grief, because it is not. Trust beyond your own ability to even believe that. Trust. Richard trusted. He was a man of humility and faith. That should be your great comfort. And just as the preacher says in Ecclesiastes, for everything there's a time, for everything. Who understands that better than the farmers? The seasons, the time. There is a time to grieve. This is that time. And yet it will only last a season. And then the time for eternal rejoicing will be ours. I pray that in this time, Christ is your hope, and your light, and your love. We pray. Eternal God, you alone are real. We are but dust, ash, vapor. We are mere shadows of clouds, too soon gone. You alone are real. Calling us by name, you gather us out of nothingness, from death. You alone are real, and through you, we are remade, eternally real, in light, in love, and in you. Amen. I did pick out a hymn of the day. It's on the little insert sheet. And if you'd be so bold as to join me in singing this hymn.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my fear and portion be, as long as life endures. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
We pray. Almighty God, in holy baptism you have knit your chosen people together in one communion of saints in the body of Christ. Give to your whole church, in heaven and on earth, your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant that all who have been baptized in Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give courage and faith to all who mourn, and a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death, our Savior, Jesus Christ, destroyed the power of death. And by his resurrection, he opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And trusting in God's love, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my light is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Richard. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen. And now we go forth in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.